Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome back to the shop for SNS episode 131. So we're going to continue on with the footage that I had shared with you last week with the intake manifold, and just go ahead and tell you that I think that job was just a complete flop, and a bunch of you called that out on the last video of the mistakes that were being made on that intake manifold, the particular machining that was wanting to be done on it. That was inexperience on my part, never working on an intake and not really thinking about it fully through the job. So I think that was my fault for not understanding what was going on there and what needed to be done. If I had a little more experience with something like that, I would have known about the water passages up inside an intake, knowing that it would cut into it doing the modifications to be requested. Now, what I had done, I went ahead and started working on it just like last week I showed you. It was set up here, and I think I got some pretty good footage of the setup and getting it ready, and a little bit of the cutting action too. So I'm going to go ahead and share some of that and show you what I had to do. And you guys are right, we cut it into the water jackets there. And I had even called the customer at that point because I hadn't finished it whenever you guys seen that video. It was still just set up right there. And I called them and talked to them about the issues and what was going on. And they said, just go ahead with, since you already got it set up, just go ahead with it. And if it doesn't work, then that's on us. So that's what I did. I went ahead and finished it out and gave it back to them, and that's that. So it was a learning experience for me. I now know what not to do on an intake like that. Again, it was something that they were just trying to use because of a project. It is a particular project. But I think the best thing to do would have been acquire the proper intake manifold instead of modifying it like that. So you guys got some good eyes out there, but that's just some of that stuff that I've never had a lot of experience in. I've been around hot rods and I had my Malibu and worked on stuff like that, but there's some things I haven't really got my hands into that much. So you live and learn. Everything you do is a learning experience, right? So anyway, we're going to throw some of that footage in there, and I've got some more viewer mail down here. We're going to take a peek at a few of them, some nice stuff that's been coming in. And again, we got a mix of things. I've got some more pictures of some jobs I've done this week that we're going to throw in there towards the end of the video, just a slideshow. If I got a couple clips, I'll throw those in there. That reminds me, I got the new iPhone, it's the new iPhone 6 Plus. So it's the big one. I love it. And it's got a slow-mo feature on the camera, which I didn't realize I did when I first got it. So I started capturing these slow-mo videos of some of the machining that I've been doing, but I post those over on social media like Facebook and Instagram. Whenever I tried to upload that to the computer to share it on a video, it doesn't copy into the computer here. So I don't know how to share that slow-mo video on YouTube. I just don't know how to do that. So the only place that I can really do it is just upload it to Facebook or Instagram. So another reason to go check out those pages anyway. Those two pages, I always update it just about every day with just fresh content, pictures, and just stuff that I'm working on throughout the day. So I'll show you what I got for this week, throw it in the video. And got a little grinder project down here on the table I've been working at. I'll give you a clip of that. And I might even have a barbecue shot to share with you too. So good mix of things. I know the channel's been a little bit quiet. It's I just had a lot going on the past couple months, and I haven't really been able to put out the videos like I have. I haven't had any big projects I've been working on, but I'm happy to at least give you an SNS once a week, but I do have some other things coming up. I already got another job done that we're gonna be putting another video out on, and I got some pistons right here that I gotta do a little bit of work on, so I think you guys might find that interesting. I haven't started yet, but that's going to be the next upcoming job project video for the channel there. We've got to work on these pistons. I still got the weld drilling shaft that I need to pull out and get started on. And I got some other things that I plan on working on around here too. So I think that's going to be about it for this episode. Look for next week. I'm probably going to release the next a t-shirt campaign, which will be the Do You Indicate Bro shirt. Still getting a lot of requests for that, so we're going to release that one next, probably next week. So stay tuned for that one, okay? All right, let's go ahead and check out some viewer mail. Got a few really nice viewer gifts that's been coming in the past couple weeks that I want to share with you now. We'll go ahead and start with this. And this was sent in by Charlie Romeo. He's out of Rockledge, Florida, and sent me a really nice letter right here, and said that I didn't have to show this, but I wanted to go ahead and show it anyway. So what he has acquired is a Royal Products Live Center number 4 Morse taper. And Royal makes very nice live centers. They make a really good product, and this one feels like it's very smooth, and that's going to come in handy around here, because that's one thing I don't have very many of is good live centers. I've got a lot of old ones over there, but there's only like 2 of them that I can actually use around here. And you know, live centers, to get a good quality one, you're gonna throw down and spend some money on. Charlie, thank you very much. This is going to be nice to use around here. We'll definitely put it in the lathe and start using it when we need it, okay? All right, so we got another viewer gift right here. And what we have is metal polish. And this was given to me by Wes Holson. And Wes is from Galesburg, Illinois. And whenever I was doing the cleanup on the new four-jaw chuck, he had noticed and emailed me and said that he had this polish that he wanted to send to me and try. Claims it's really good. So I believe it's Zephyr Pro 40 metal polish. And it's a 2-part polish here. He's got a little note about it right here. So I haven't used it yet on the chuck, but I'm going to give it a shot and see what it does. So Wes, thank you very much for the new metal polish there. That's very nice. Okay, now we got one more right here, and this comes to us all the way from New Zealand. And this was given to me by Richard Ashman from New Zealand. He is from Palmerston North, New Zealand. You got a really nice note, and what it is an old Sterrett catalog. This is pretty neat too, because it's fun to go through these books and look at the tools and everything that they had in these old catalogs. And you'll notice that it's black and white. The newer catalog is color. And the other thing that I noticed going through here is that there's no electronic equipment in this book right here. Very cool to look at. A lot of the tools that many of us have around the shop are in this book. And I had looked at this whenever it come in, and I believe the copyright on it, this says copyright 1965, 4th edition, but revised in 1970. So maybe this one right here was printed in 1970. I don't really know. It's the catalog number 27. I bet James Green probably has a little more info on that, but anyway, awesome book. I haven't really looked through it fully yet, but it's going to be a nice one to look through. And Richard, thank you very much. It's going to go in the collection inside on the bookshelf. And thank you for sending it my way. All right, we got one more right here. This is a big, heavy box, and I'm going to bring the camera down and give you a better look at this one, okay? So this box was sent in by George Goodman from Hull, Massachusetts, and it's a heavy box, but I want you to check this out, what he's done. So we got our note there. I've already removed the screws. I checked it out when it came in, and this is George Goodman. I'm sorry. He is into caning, wood caning, I believe it is, furniture caning. And he's got a nice letter right there, and tells me that about himself, that he was a teacher for a very long time about the caning process, and he's now retired and does it at home. But he found this stuff, and he said that he wanted me to have it, so he sent it my way. Look at there. Remember a while back I had mentioned I was looking for a nice angular cutter for the horizontal mill? Well, he run across this lot of cutters, and he wanted to send them my way. And man, they look beautiful just sitting out in that wooden box like that. I like the way George has gone through the extra effort to make sure that the box didn't bust open, and he separated all of them with these little strips of wood here. Very cool. So you got two of them down here on the end that are still in the peel coat. I don't know if they're regrinds or they're still brand new. I would assume that they're new. And we'll go ahead and take out one of these and take a look at it. But every single one of them are sharp, so they look like they've been reground. That one's a brown and sharp. So I haven't removed all of them. I've just kind of left them like this. So what I want to do, they're in a nice little setup just the way they are. So I plan on keeping them like this, and I'm going to keep them down here on my shelf. And when I need a cutter, I'll go in here and I'll look for them. But a lot of these look like they're the same. It's just duplicates. So that was very kind of you, George. Thank you very much for thinking of me and sending them my way. I really appreciate it. You did a great job on the boxing. And the letter was very cool. Thank you for sharing your story with me. And I hope that we can put these to good use, man. This is a small little project that I've been kind of tinkering with a little bit this week, and I hadn't really given much thought to do any video on it, but I figured, what the hell, we'll go ahead and do a little segment, because it's something involving the shop that I'm working on, and it's going to be around here, so I'll just go ahead and tell you about it. So that's an old Miller's Falls bench grinder, and I bought that from the flea market earlier in the summer. I've had it, I don't know, 3 or 4 months now, and I never did show it, but it works good, and I paid the man $40 for it, and it was a fully equipped grinder with all of the guards and one of the tool rests. This tool rest, it goes in right here, slides in that hole, and you got the tool rest there. Now, one of these was missing, but that's the only thing that was missing off of it. It had all of the guards, all the heavy steel guards, including these guards right here. The way they actually used to make good quality tools, man. You know, that's some good stuff right there. So what am I doing to it? Well, something that I've been wanting to add to my arsenal around here, I'm really wanting to improve my sanding and deburring department, that kind of stuff. You know, support machines, grinders and sanders. I've been wanting to invest in a nice Baldor polisher buffer type motor, which looks like this, except it's a lot bigger, and it comes out just like this. You don't have any guards on it, and they're made for putting a polishing wheel on there. Now, I believe Tom Lipton has one exactly like what I'm wanting to get. I think they hold, it's considered an 8-inch, but you can put any size wheel on it that you want. So whenever I seen this grinder and I got it for a good price, I just figured, you know, I might be able to do the same thing with that. So that's exactly what I'm doing. I took the guards off, and I've already got this wire wheel on this side right here. Now, one other thing that was missing on this side was the washer, the backup washer, which like that. So I do need to make a proper washer for that size. I haven't got to it yet, but I will. So on this side, what I'm going to do is I've ordered a Scotch-Brite deburring wheel, 6-inch deburring wheel, 6-inch by 1-inch wide, and I'm going to mount that on this side right here. And that's what I've been wanting. I want a deburring wheel on one side and a wire wheel on the other side that doesn't have anything in the way, any guards or tool rest in the way for you to jam up. So that's what I'm doing with this old Miller Falls grinder right here. So I'm going to I'm not going to throw those guards away. I tell you what, if anybody out there has this grinder and needs those parts, let me know, and I will donate those right there. If you need a tool rest, a guard, or something like that. So I have it plugged in, and it's a nice, smooth running grinder. It's a little out of balance because of this wire wheel right here. That's not a perfectly balanced wheel, but it is very smooth without this. And it's funny, this was the grinding wheel that was on this side right here. It was a Montgomery Ward grinding wheel. I've never seen Montgomery Ward's name on a grinding wheel before. And there was another wire wheel on this side. It was heavily worn out, so I just threw it away. Now you can see how that wheel is not perfectly balanced there. So that's what's causing a little bit of vibration. So that's the plan with this right here, just a little small shop project. And what I'm wanting to try to do is that this corner right here, I'm not happy with this, and it's not set up very user friendly. I know it looks like a mess right now with extension cords. I need to do work on electrical power outlets, proper, you know, installs. There's the big belt sander right there. I haven't used it in a while because the belt broke on me and it scared me last time that happened. So I haven't used it since then. I need to put another belt on it, which I have some. They're out in the shed. But that grinder right there is the one that we've always used. And it's an oldie also. And it works good. See, it's got plenty of power. There's nothing wrong with this grinder right here. But I don't like these these right here that hold your tool rest. And I don't like this. It's just, you need to have that wire wheel out in the open so that you don't get caught up in it and sling something around and gets caught in the guards. So I want to do the same thing with like this right here. I'm going to build a pedestal or something, and I'll have this other Miller Falls grinder set up. And I want to get a different belt sander too. This is nice. That's that big boy 80, I think it is, 6-inch wide belt. I think it's an 80-inch long belt. It's real heavy duty, but it's lightweight. The stand's lightweight. I want something else besides that. I want something like like Jet and Wilton sells the more vertical style of belt sander with the round disc on the side. I've been looking at those. I'd like to invest something like that to work a little bit better for what I need. You know, I still hold on to this and put it outside or something, but I want to try to improve this whole area right here and have more grinders and wire wheels and that kind of stuff on this side. This desk, I need to do something with that. I still use it, but it's all for storage, and I hate this. This is all just, you know, stuff that I just can't get rid of. That's mail and books, and I got storage underneath there. But I need to do something with that cabinet. I just don't want to get rid of it, you know. I just don't have no room to put it anywhere. But anyway, I'll quit rambling on, but that's still a little shop project. And whenever I get the Scotch-Brite wheel, I will we'll get it mounted on there. I'll show you that. And whenever I start making a pedestal or something for it, you know, I'll share that with you too, okay? I'd like to do another A-Bomb photo challenge entry real quick. I haven't done any of those in a while, so we're gonna throw one in the mix here. So the one I want to show you comes to us from Kevin Hart. And I don't believe that this is the Kevin Hart that we know from the big screen, the comedian. I think this is a different Kevin Hart. And he is from Tennessee. And the pictures that he has sent me, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about his email here, is, okay, you guys remember back whenever we had built the rotary welding table, I had that logo there, that A-Bomb 79 logo, as well as a couple other ones sent off to have chrome plated. Here's the other one that I had chrome plated. I believe I had three of them done, two of these and that one. And Kevin says that he lives just down the street from Tri-City Plating, which is who did the chrome plating there. So he thought that was pretty interesting, and he got a couple pictures there to share with us and show the building and that kind of stuff. So I'll give you a little bit of his email here, and we'll show the pictures as we talk. So he says that it's a real old school place that goes back to at least the 1950s. And he said he couldn't get a good picture because they don't have a real sign anymore. Road Expansions took out their sign, but he's got his phone held up with my logo on it from the video in front of one of their trucks. You can also see an old part of the building there, but he couldn't get a wide enough shot to cover it all. And in the backyard, you can see all of the bumpers that's laying out there in the yard, just shining away like ever. So that's pretty neat. Neat old building, and the place has definitely got some history. He's also got one more picture here of a Kennametal sign. And he says that down the road from his dad's house is an old Kennametal plant, and he believes they used to make carbide inserts there. And his dad, his dad's got some swag from the old plant. But he said he drove by and thought of me and all of the rest of the YouTubers that praise the Kennametal tooling. So that's very cool, Kevin. And I appreciate you sending it in, and I'm glad that I got to share him here on the SNS video. So I've got some plans to possibly send some more stuff like this out there to Tri-City eventually in the future to get chrome plated. So I'll be thinking about you whenever I do that. So we're moving on with the setup, and we're now over here on the K&T mill. And I wanted to give you a shot of what I've been working on. This kind of stuff can be, this is a little bit of a tricky setup. I changed it up just a bit from what I did on the do-all mill, and I wanted to utilize a couple machinist jacks. So I've got two of the Sterrett machinist jacks in there. I'll show you those. But basically what we're doing is a three-point system. I've got one side of the manifold sitting down on this end, and I've got two jacks on that end, and I've been adjusting it to get it level both directions. I've got it pretty close. I need to do a little bit of fine tweaking there, but this isn't any kind of high precision stuff right there. I've got it really, really close, and I'm probably going to leave it about where it's at. I've been messing with it, and these kind of setups can take a little time, and they can run up a lot of video time. So I was trying to get it really close and then kind of show you what I got going on and try to explain everything. So as I said, we've got it sitting on that end on this parallel, and I'm using that right height style of clamp, and I had to shim it just a little bit to get it to pull flat like it needed to, flat and square against that surface there. And on this end here is where we got the two machinist jacks there. And those are good clamps with nice sharp serrations there on the pad so that they'll hold real good. And just a couple strap clamps there using my 5/8 hardware and some step blocks. And then on the back, we've got my Sterrett indicator set up. And believe it or not, you probably won't believe it, I set this thing up right here to check squareness this way. And all I did was just line it up by sight like this. Just bumped it around a little bit, and I started snugging it down. So I come down here to the hand wheel to check it, and I haven't bumped it or anything, but look at that. It hasn't moved, and I haven't bumped it around to indicate it. So it looks like we got lucky on that. So again, I need to do a little bit of final snugging of all three of the clamps there, and I've been leveling it this way and, you know, both directions, getting really close. So we're just about there. And then what we'll do is I'll come in here and I'll indicate one of these holes, get it true, and I'm going to measure this hole pattern, and then we'll just use the digital readout to move our offsets that we need to, and use an inch and a half in the mill and go down there and counterboard about a half inch deep so that it'll get a little bit more airflow through there. Okay, we're setting up the indicator to sweep in the first hole. That'll be our zero location. So what I got going on, this is a really nice interrapid test indicator that I've had for some time, that it's just one of those that stays put up in the box and you kind of forget that you have it every now and then. And I had pulled it out and put it to where I could remember to use it. So that's what we're doing, and using this little mini Noga with the mag base, and I just got it stuck to the bottom of the spindle here. This test indicator has got its own nice little arm that kind of stays with it, that goes in this hole right here, and you tighten it up, and this is sort of an articulating arm that works really well too. But this Noga is actually what I need here, because I can stick it right to the spindle with the magnet. So we've got it kind of close, so let me go ahead and let's see if we can get this thing sweeped in, see what's going on here. and I'm trying to keep my hands off of the indicator holder. I'm just touching the spindle here. And then other than our fine adjust that I can use to bring the indicator back in to touch. So now we need to bring it in some. So preloaded a little there. All right, that's close enough. I'm moving around a little bit, but that's pretty much zero right there. All right. As I was afraid of. Get a little bit of chatter here. Try to take it easy and not make any too hard movements on it. I'm using power feed right there. That's the slowest feed I got. 0.2 inches per minute. That's going to be a heavy cut right here. So I think on these two here, I want to go ahead and relieve some of it with a smaller end mill first, and then go back in with the inch and a half. So we'll go ahead and step it over to this one here. I'm gonna switch my readout up here to metric. And I said that was 48 millimeter. All right, there's 48 millimeter. So we're going to go ahead and repeat. So I moved over to this side. I'm using that's a brand new 3/4 2 flute end mill. I'm going to rough out the middle of it. So yes, you can see on this hole right here where we cut through into this cavity. I believe this is for vacuum over here, and I've actually talked to the guy that's having this done right here, and I've been telling him about the issues of drilling and tapping through, cutting through it like this, and he asked me just to go ahead with this, and if it doesn't work, that's on him. But he's planning on sealing it up, and as far as this side goes, if we cut into that water jacket, if this is water cooled up through here, I can fill a hole. I don't really know what he's going to do about that. I don't agree with this either, and I should have thought about it a little bit better before I agreed to do it, but I'm going to go ahead, since I've gone this far, I'm going to complete it, and this is going to be the last intake manifold that this guy works on around here, I'll tell you that. Going in with an inch and a half now. There's a look at our handiwork, and I believe everybody that called, you're going to be cutting into your the water jacket. I believe you're right. I can blow air in here, and it's coming out where the filler neck here, where the water neck goes. So I guess this side is going to be for water. This side over here, I think, is maybe vacuum. I'm not quite sure. I've never done any machine work on something like this. I've had my fair share of working on cars and being around hot rods and that kind of stuff, but going in here and doing modifications and stuff is something I've never done. And again, this is the kind of stuff right here that I just don't want to mess with, man. It's just I believe this is just a waste of time right here, and they should have just went ahead and just bought what they needed instead of trying to have somebody modify it. But it's a learning lesson, isn't it? I know it is for me anyway. So I'm ready to get this thing unclamped and get it out of the shop. We'll see you guys later. All right, I got my new Scotch-Brite wheel in today. Didn't take but just a few seconds to install it. And I'm gonna go ahead and test it out and see what it does. So this will be a good wheel for deburring parts and putting a polish on other parts. I've never got to use one before. This will be the first one I've ever had, so I'll get to experiment with it. I got a couple things here I'm going to try it out with, though, and see. Got a nice blue point hammer right here. Let's see what it does on there. Puts a nice little polish on it. Okay. All right, here's a piece of flat bar that's got the edges on it there from the saw cut. I want to be careful not to dig in there. Yeah, but it's deburring it there. It's got a nice soft edge on it now. So I can see where you got small parts, maybe some small delicate parts that you want to do some deburring with. You can come over here and hit it. All right, here's a piece of aluminum flat bar, same way. It's got a rough cut edge right there. Polish the aluminum a little bit there. All right, that'll work. Next phase is to get a pedestal made up for it. Hey guys, so weekend again, and I'm out here doing some more smoking. And since the last time that I talked to you here, I've learned a few more things. I've been reading a new book, and I enjoyed reading a lot of comments that I got last week about the different things that I had talked about. So today, I actually went back to, or this weekend should I say, because I did it yesterday and today, I went back to smoking using some real wood. Got it going over there. I'm doing pretty good maintaining between 250 and 300 around the grate temp. And I got, there's a little bit left right there, but I bought a bag of hickory wood, and I don't like doing that because you just pay way too much money for a little bag of wood like that, but it's been enough for me to use here all weekend. But my plan is to start getting some pecan. That's what I really like to use, pecan wood, and there's plenty of it around here. I just got to get it. There's people who actually cut it, split it, and sell it, so I'd like to maybe do that. But there's also ways you can just pick it up. So I'm going to start working on some pecan wood, getting some stacked and have over there, and use that for my smoker out here. But it's been doing pretty good so far today with the hickory wood. It's been working real well. And yesterday I did the same thing. I did a couple of chickens, and I had I had taken them out there to my mom's. We had a little birthday dinner for my sister, and we did some seafood and some other stuff. I took the chickens out there, but I left those. I left what was left of it with the family because they don't get to have all this smoked meat all that often. So I left it with them. So today I decided I want to cook me two more. And the reason why is because I like it myself. It turned out really good. And it gives me leftovers for the week. I've mentioned that before. So, you know, today, whenever this is cooled down, I'll take it and I'll split it all up and I'll break it, you know, I'll break it apart and put it in a container, and then I'll have some chicken to eat on throughout the week. I take a little bit for lunch. There goes the smoker going down the road. Somebody's pulling it behind the truck and it's actually smoking. But yeah, I'll take a salad for lunch, and I'll usually take a little bit of chicken, and that's like a meal that I like to have for lunch. I do try to eat kind of healthy. I know I'm not perfect by no means, but I've cut way back on like sugar intake, and I try to cut back on fatty intake, that kind of stuff. You know, as regards to barbecue, I still eat some barbecue. But anyway, I thought I would tell you about that. Been having some good luck with the grill today. I'll show you the chickens. You can see I put a couple new thermometers in there that I picked up at Walmart when I was in there. There's cheap charbroil, but the ones I had in there were not working right at all. They weren't showing the right temp. So we got the wood going. I actually need to cut it back. Let me cut it back a little bit. Starting to raise. It's getting hotter than what I want it to. So there's the chickens there. And they're doing good, and I'm telling you, man, they taste really good. So that's just salt, pepper, garlic, and onion is what that rub is. And I got my eye grill going. So we're getting pretty close, about 150 degrees now. So I thought I'd show you this book that I bought right here by Aaron Franklin. And you know, I've been talking about Aaron Franklin. He's pretty famous now over there in Austin, Texas for his barbecue. And he's got this book. And I gotta say, I'm not much of a book reader. I do like my machinist books, but this book right here has captivated me. And that's how much I've read in just, I don't know, 3 or 4 days. And this has got Aaron's entire story in it. And it's very interesting to hear about how Aaron got into barbecue. He's only been doing this for 13 years. And he's about my age. I think he's about 2 years older than me. So that's an excellent book to read. The story about how he got started in barbecue is just unreal. I mean, the dude is just really inspiring hearing his story. And how well he does his barbecue. He's really learned the art of barbecuing, not just making good meat. He's learned the science behind the wood, everything it has to do with wood and the fire and the smoke. He has learned it all, and he makes some excellent barbecue. And they said that every single day since 2009, the day he opened the doors, he has sold out of meat every single day. That's got to go. And that says something for him. You know, he's done good. But so I'm going through that book and I'm learning. It's an excellent book to read if you're interested in smoked foods, smoked meat like brisket. That's the main thing, is the brisket. But he goes into ribs too, and turkey and sausage. He's got other recipes in there like barbecue sauces. I just made a barbecue sauce today that was in that book. And that's my little barbecue sauce container right there, but I made a couple of those. And he's got some different sauces in his book. And it's just a great book. I'm enjoying reading it. That's what I've been doing today. Smoking, I'm replying to comments from SNS, and I've been reading a book. So that's what my Sunday's looking like. Hopefully during the week I'll get back in the shop here and we'll get some more machine work done and have some metalworking content for you. All right, see you later.